Yeah, if you would. I can do it if you prefer, but. She comes in, there's boxes of masks in her car. Bring me a box of masks. I don't think she's coming now that I think about it because of Jack. But if you do see her, just go. They just about run out. And I have all the extras and I forgot to bring them.
Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. That's what we're here today to do, to worship our God, to praise him. He's calling us to praise him. He desires our worship and our praise. And so we gather as his people on the Lord's day to do just that, to praise him, to worship him, to give him thanks. I'm going to begin with a prayer asking the Holy Spirit to be with us and to help us during this time, to help us to worship and to help us to hear his word and believe his word. Will you stand or kneel where you are in your pew? Stand or kneel. I'm going to pray this prayer and then we'll go right into the confession of sin. You'll find it underneath in bold. We'll pray that all together. I'll begin and then you pray with me the confession of sin. Come, O Holy Spirit, come. Direct us and defend us. Strengthen us and comfort us. Confirm us and gladden us. Mold us for yourself. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Father in heaven, we have sinned against you by what we have done and by what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. Forgive us our sins as we forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Give us the power to obey you and to love all people. We ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let each of us now come before the face of the Lord, confessing our own sins silently to God. Pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. The blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, acknowledge them, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is the word of God.
If you will stand with us, let's sing together Our Father. The lyrics are in your bulletin. We do ask, as always, that while we're singing or speaking together as a congregation, that you wear your mask. Thank you.
Oh,
If you look in your Bibles to Psalm 49 on page 887. We're going to read this psalm together. I'll begin with the odd verse, first verse, and you respond with the next verse, and we'll just go that way back and forth. For the director of music of the sons of Korah, a psalm, Psalm 49. Hear this, all you peoples. Listen, all who live in this world. My mouth will speak words of wisdom. The utterance from my heart will give understanding. Why should I fear when evil day comes, when evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me? No man can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for him. That he should live on forever and not see decay. Their tombs will remain their houses forever, their dwellings for endless generations, though they had named lands after themselves.
But man, despite his riches, does not endure. He is like the beasts that perish.
This is the fate of those who trust in themselves and of their followers who approve their sayings.
Like sheep, they are destined for the grave, and death will feed on them. The upright will rule over them in the morning. Their forms will decay in the grave, far from their princely mansions.
But God will redeem my life from the grave. He will surely take me to himself.
Do not be overawed when a man grows rich, when the splendor of his house increases.
For he will take nothing with him when he dies. His splendor will not descend with him.
Though while he lived, he counted himself blessed, and men praise you when you prosper.
He will join the generation of his fathers who will never see the light of life.
A man who has riches without understanding is like the beasts that perish.
This is the word of God.
We've been reading through the book of Exodus on Sunday mornings for our Old Testament readings, and we've come to chapter 28. We're going to read verses 1 through 30 this morning. It's on page 130 of your blue Bible. The Lord has given Moses the garment, the priestly garments. Exodus chapter 28, verses 1 through 30. Have Aaron, your brother, brought to you from among the Israelites, along with his sons Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar, so they may serve me as priests. Make sacred garments for your brothers Aaron, and give him dignity and honor. Tell all the skilled men to whom I have given wisdom in such matters that they are to make garments for Aaron for his consecration, so he may serve me as priest. These are the garments they are to make: a breastpiece, an ephod, a robe, a woven tunic, a turban, and a sash. They are to make these sacred garments for your brother Aaron and his sons, so they may serve me as priests. Have them use gold and blue and purple and scarlet yarn with fine linen. Make the ephod of gold and of blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and of finely twisted linen, the work of a skilled craftsman. It is to have two shoulder pieces attached to two of its corners so it can be fastened. Its skillfully woven waistband is to be like it, of one piece with the ephod, and made with gold and with blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and with finely twisted linen. Take two onyx stones and engrave on them the number of the sons of Israel, in the order of their birth, six names on one stone the remaining six on the other. Engrave the names of the sons of Israel on the two stones the way a gem cutter engraves a seal. Then mount the stones in gold, filigree settings, and fasten them on the shoulder pieces of the ephod as memorial stones for the sons of Israel. Aaron is to bear the names on his shoulders as a memorial before the Lord. Make gold filigree settings and two braided chains of pure gold like a rope, and attach the chains to the settings. Fashion a breastpiece for making decisions, the work of a skilled craftsman. Make it like the ephod of gold and of blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, and of finely twisted linen. It is to be square, a span long and a span wide, and folded double. Then mount four rows of precious stones on it. In the first row there shall be a ruby, a topaz, and a beryl. In the second row, a turquoise, a sapphire, and an emerald. In the third row, a jacinth, an agate, and an amethyst. In the fourth row, a chrysolite, an onyx, and a jasper. Mount them in gold filigree settings. There are to be 12 stones, one for each of the names of the sons of Israel, each engraved like a seal with the name of the 12 tribes. For the breastpiece, make braided chains of pure gold like a rope. Make two gold rings for it and fasten them to the two corners of the breastpiece. Fasten the two gold chains to the rings at the corners of the breastpiece, and to the other ends of the chains to two settings, attaching them to the shoulder pieces of the ephod at the front. Make two gold rings, attach them to the other two corners of the breastpiece on the inside edge next to the ephod. Make two more gold rings and attach them to the bottom of the shoulder pieces on the front of the ephod, close to them, seam just above the waistband of the ephod. The rings of the breastpiece are to be tied to the rings of the ephod with blue cord connecting it to the waistband, so that the breastpiece will not swing out from the ephod. Whenever Aaron enters the holy place, he will bear the names of the sons of Israel over his heart on the breastpiece of decision as a continuing memorial before the Lord. Also, put the Urim and the Thummim in the breastpiece so they may be over Aaron's heart whenever he enters the presence of the Lord. Thus Aaron will always bear the means of making decisions for the Israelites over his heart before the Lord. This is the reading of the word of God. Thanks be to the Lord.
If you will stand and take your hymnals out, let's turn to page 44 and sing together How Great Thou Art. Page 44. Let's stand together.
Yeah. sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When thou shalt come, there shall be
your Bibles to Ephesians, the third chapter. Ephesians chapter 3. We've been here, we weren't here last week, but we've been here for a while, most weeks. Coming to the end of the chapter, we hope today. Right after the long prayer we went through the last few weeks, been looking at that prayer, and now we come to a doxology at the end of the prayer, a moment of praise when Paul gives praise to God. We're going to look at that today. Let's pray before we read that together. Father, I pray that you would be with me now, that you would give me the words, that you would give me the ability to say what needs to be said. I pray for all of us in this room, including me, that you would give us the encouragement that we need, the encouragement that comes from your word, the comfort, the lifting up, the strengthening that comes from this word and from these truths. By your Holy Spirit, Father, help us to hear. Dig us ears, Lord, that we can hear. Give us faith. Give us the ability to hear this and to feel it and to know it and to respond to it with praise and joy. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a verse in Zechariah, the prophecy of Zechariah, that says, "Their hearts shall be glad as with wine. Their hearts shall be glad as with wine." And I have to say that this week, without the help of wine, my heart has been very glad. As I have been meditating on these two verses, it has lifted me up and made me joyful and made me glad and made just given me lightness and a pure delight in these truths that are in these two verses. My heart has been glad as with wine. My heaviness is lifted. All the things that are troubling and all the things that are going wrong around us have been sort of lifted off of me just by the magnificence and the glory of this truth and these truths that are in this passage. And I hope that some of you will be able to receive that this morning from these same words by the work of the Holy Spirit. It has nothing to do with me. It's purely the work of the Holy Spirit and the truth of His Word. I know that some of you struggle to pay attention to sermons. I do too, so I totally sympathize with that. So what I'm going to do, I've decided to do, is front load this sermon. What I mean by that is give me 5 minutes, okay? Those of you who fade out, And I'm not blaming you for it. I fade out myself. Those of you who fade out, can you give me 5 minutes? I'm going to try to front load it and give you the heart of the matter in 5 minutes. And then I'll give the rest people who are still hanging on, if anyone is, still hanging on after that, I'll give them a little bit more. And then we're going to go to a time of prayer, or actually a time of praise. So let me look at the verse with me here. We've been hearing about God's infinite love in the verses before. Verse 18 and 19, we've heard about God's infinite love, and now we're going to hear about God's infinite power, okay? And the two are coming together. Don't forget about the love now that you're hearing about the power, because they're connected, his infinite love and his infinite power. So look at verse 20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. Now to him, I'm going to just read that. Now to him, God, who is able to do, has the power to do, there's his power, his ability, it's connected to the word for power. Now to him who has the power to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And one scholar that I read, it translated it this way, who is able, who has the power to do infinitely more abundantly beyond. Because the words here are just piled up. It's he's trying to say something. It's beyond what you could. It's just incredible. It's infinite beyond even what you can ask or think. Infinitely more abundantly beyond what we ask or think. All that we can ask or think. And so what he's saying here is God. And he's not just saying. Some could take this as he's just saying God has the ability to do that. He might not, but he has the ability. That's not what Paul's saying. By saying he has the ability to it, he has the power to do it, he's saying this is what, in fact, he is going to do. He has the power to do it. He has infinite love, infinite power, and he is going to bring to pass something infinitely more abundantly beyond all we ask or imagine. I want you to hear that this morning. I want you to try to stretch your mind to get a grasp that things are so way beyond what you've ever thought about, so way beyond what you've ever asked for in prayer, so way beyond anything you've ever imagined. This is Paul, the Apostle Paul, telling us this and promising us this, that God is going to exceed infinitely every prayer you've ever made, every thought you've ever had about how things could go well, every wish you've ever had about. He's not saying he's going to give you all your fantasies and all your wishes. He's saying what he is going to do, what he is going to give, what he is going to accomplish is beyond any all those silly fantasies, all those good prayers, all those wishes, all that imagination, all your thought about this. What he's going to do will so far exceed it all, it will leave you standing completely overwhelmed and gaping. He said, yeah, I asked for this, but that was absurd because look what it really is. I thought about this, but that was absurd because look what it really is. Look what God is really doing. Look what God has really done. And he's talking about what God is doing in history, first of all, but he's talking about also what he's going to do in history, what he's going to do in that final restoration, what the Bible calls the restoration, and the final restoration, and then what he's going to do in eternity, in the new age beyond that, the new heavens and the new earth. He's telling us, and I want you to hear this, that most of us don't have any idea what we're talking about or what Christianity is about. We don't have any idea what Jesus has done. We don't have the clearest, the little tinkling in our minds is so impoverished, is so ridiculously small compared to what Jesus has done. Jesus has done something and is going to accomplish something by his sacrifice that will leave our wildest imagination in the dust. He is doing something amazing. He is doing something immeasurably more and infinitely more abundantly beyond anything you have ever thought, anything you have ever asked. And so what that means is these health and wealth people who preach the gospel of health and wealth, they're right in one sense. They're right in one sense. What they're wrong about is how silly small their preaching is. Their preaching is about in this life, if you just put your faith in God, he's going to give you health and wealth. No, that's not what the Bible says. What the Bible says is that in the age to come, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, he's going to give you infinitely more, abundantly more than you can even comprehend. Money is a joke compared to what's coming. Health for 70 years or 80 years or 90 years on this earth, That's a joke compared to what he's giving. He is giving something so much more glorious, so much. They've got their eyes on, in the dirt, and many of us have our eyes down in the dirt when what Jesus is doing is, I mean, hear Paul's words, infinitely more abundantly beyond all that we can ask or imagine. There is a new creation that is being made by Jesus' blood, a new creation that is being made by the work of the Holy Spirit. This is something immense and mind-boggling and beyond. In other words, all that to say, the good news, when we call this the gospel, the good news, it's because it is good news. It's because it's unthinkably good. It is unimaginably good. It is fantastically good. It is wondrously good. It is mind-bogglingly good. I don't know how many more adverbs I can reach for there, but it is unthinkingly good. The good news. And that's my 5 minutes, so okay, you can shut down. There's my 5 minutes, okay? So I hope you got that. And I hope you'll take that home and ponder that, because I want you to understand the Christian message is so much better than you've probably ever understood or gotten your head around. It's so much more joyous and wonderful. Good, when the Bible says good news, most of us are like, yeah, it's good news. Yeah, it's good news. You know, it's the Bible means good news. Do you know when the apostles would go into a town and they would tell them the message of the gospel, the people were stunned by what they were saying. They were stunned because they were saying, we know the one who is the Son of God, who God, and this isn't one of your gods, who has limited power and limited knowledge and is not righteous or good. We're talking about the God of the universe who created all things is good. He is pure goodness and pure love and pure mercy. And to show us that, he sent his Son, who is also God, into the world. And he came into this world and he suffered on behalf of us, ordinary human beings, sinful human beings. He came and he suffered for us to give us all things, to save all things, to save the universe. Cosmic salvation is what he is doing. He is saving, he is making a new creation. Revelation, behold, I make all things new. This is what Jesus is doing. And when they would preach that to people, the people would be like, what? What? They had never ever heard a message that was good news like this good news. Their religions were super bad news compared to this. This was good news, mind-boggling good news like they had never heard before. And then they would say, and what do we have to do? What do we have to go do now? What do we have to now achieve now? How many prayers do we have to say? How much worship? How much incense do we have to burn? How many good deeds do we have to do? How much money do we have to give? And the apostles would say, nothing. Nothing. There is nothing. This is a free gift. Do you believe that Jesus is Lord and he is going to save the universe? Do you believe that? It's yours. It's yours. And it caught like wildfire, and it burned. It burned through the Gentile terror and the people. It was good news to them. It set their hearts on fire. These were poor people. These were sick people. These were people who suffered under injustice. Many of them, a lot of them were slaves. A lot of them were, you know, from the poor areas of society. They had suffered terrible loss. People died so much earlier at this point. They'd all had lost so many people. They had so much sickness that they couldn't do anything about. They didn't have modern medicine. They had so much sadness, so much loss, so much death all around them. And someone came in and said, God has sent his Son, and his Son is going to save anyone who will simply turn to him in faith. Turn to him in faith. Put their faith in him. He is going to save. He is going to, and he's not just pulling us out. He is coming in. He is returning. And when he returns, he is healing it all. He is restoring it all. He is creating the new heavens and the new earth. And what do I have to do? Believe in Jesus. Believe Jesus is Lord. Believe he is Messiah and King. Believe he is Savior. Look to him in faith. Look to him for salvation. Believe the good news. That's how Jesus said it. In one sense, when he was going around preaching, one of the descriptions of Jesus' thing was, he said, believe the good news. That's what you have to do. Believe the good news about Jesus. Now, The problem in all this is that the devil is a liar, and he lies to me and you every day. He's been lying to you, and he's been lying to me. And a lot of us, we listen to him sometimes. We listen to the lies the devil tells us. What kind of lies is the devil telling you? He's telling you lies like this. God is not really doing something that good. It's not really good. It's not really that good. It's not really that amazing what God's doing. He tells us God's not really going to break in and do anything. Hasn't this been going on year after year for centuries and centuries? This is never going to change. It's just going to be the same way, and things just get worse and things get bad. Some things get better for a while, then they get worse again. That's not going to change. This is just going to go on and on and on. And God's never coming. He's never going to break in. He's never returning. The Lord Jesus is never returning. What other lies is he telling you? He's telling you the lie. Your sin, that sin in your life, that disgusting mess in your life, those problems that you have, those failures that you've committed, those things that you keep doing over and over again, that the stuff you tried to do and you failed at, the sin in your life, that means that you don't get God's goodness. That means you're not a part of God's goodness. God's coming with goodness, sure, but you're not going to be a part of it. You think you're going to be a part of it? You can't have this because of your sin. Of course, that's a lie. That's Satan's lie. That's Satan's lie because sin, evil, is forgiven by the blood of Jesus, right? And so the goodness is for sinners. The goodness is for people who've done evil things. The goodness, the love, the mercy is for failures, people who have failed. The devil lies to us and he says, you're suffering. Look at your suffering. It means that none of this is real. It means that none of this is really real. Suffering is what is real. What's in your face right now, that's what's real. There's nothing beyond it. There's no hope. This is only going to get, some of those sufferings you have aren't going away. They're not going to get any better. There's no hope. This is all that there is. There's nothing beyond this. There's no real deliverance. There's no real salvation. There's no real rescue. There's no real restoration. Renewal, as the scriptures teach us, as the gospel says there is. Another lie that we're told is your heart is so dead. You have your feelings. You have hardly any feelings. Your lack of excitement, your lack of love, your lack of joy, that shows that God's not with you. That shows that God is not with you, and he's not going to deliver you. He's not going to rescue you. It shows that you have nothing to do with God. Your heart's too dead to be with God. That's a lie from the devil. That's the devil when we're overwhelmed by bad emotions and when we're sad or when we're overcome. That's the devil coming in and saying, those emotions, that's reality. That's the truth. God's word about what he's doing and what he's going to do apart from your emotions coming and going, that's not true. What's true is your emotions. Your emotions show that you're dead. You're a loser. You've lost God. God's abandoned you. You don't have God. Lies, lies, lies. And I could go on. We could talk about, you could probably stand up and tell me the lies the devil's been telling you this month. The lies that you've heard from the devil and that you've been believing. When God's word tells us the Lord Jesus is coming to save, that he's already saving. And he is continuing to save, and he is returning to save, and he is doing something and is going to do something that is beyond our wildest imaginations, beyond what we can think and beyond what we can ask. And the news is good news, good, glorious news, unthinkingly good, unimaginably good, fantastically good, wonderfully good. Don't believe the devil, believe the good news about Jesus. Don't believe the devil. Don't believe his lies. He speaks to you when your emotions are stirred up sometimes. He speaks to you when something falls apart in your life. He speaks to you when, the situation in your life goes, you hear the devil talking to you and telling you lies about what, pulling you away from what God's word says, what the good news is about Jesus Christ, that he is coming. And by the way, God doesn't reject us even for having weak faith. Some of us say, but my faith is so weak, I have trouble believing this. Of course you have trouble believing this. Newsflash, we all have trouble believing this. We all have times, especially where we have trouble believing this. There's doubt mixed with faith. We have faith, but then sometimes we struggle. Sometimes our faith becomes weaker. We need God's help even to believe, and so we cry out for help. But even, you know, that's why the smallest bit of faith is all that it takes. God doesn't reject us for weak faith. You know, we're like that woman who was, that story, I think we just read this not too long ago, that woman who was bleeding. She's been bleeding within for 12 years, and no one can help her. She has sought all the help that was available. She has spent all the money she has. She has sought out all the help that there is in the world around her and, you know, gone everywhere that she can get to get help with this bleeding going on within her. For 12 years, she's been bleeding. She is miserable. Her life is a wreck. This is what's happening within her, and she knows that this one is sent from God, that this, maybe she even knows that he's the Messiah. She knows something about him, that he is sent from God, and she simply knows that he can heal her, and she simply reaches out and says that the scriptures tell us that she touched the hem of his garment in faith, saying, there's no healing in me, there's only sickness in me, but I know that the healing of God is in him, and the healing poured into her, and she was healed by Jesus, by his power, by his love, by what he was. The healing poured into her and healed her. And it's the same way for us. We have within us our suffering. We have within us our loss. We have within us our sin, our very real sin. Not sins to laugh at, not sins that are slight, but real, serious sins we have in our life. We have these sins within us, all these things that are wrecking us and are like within us, like the bleeding within the woman. But we are told to look in faith to the one, the only one who can heal us. We're not told that in this moment, this second of this day on the calendar, that all the healing will come, but we are told that the healing is coming. The healing is real. It begins now, as Paul says in Philippians, God began a good work in you, and he will bring it to completion. He is going to take it through to the end. What he's already begun, he will take through to the very end if we touch the hem of his garment. Look at the end of verse 20. Let me read the whole thing again. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more, to God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. That's what I sort of already just said. He's saying, you know, that power has already begun within us, within the church, within Christians. It's already part of our past history. We've already seen, maybe we're not sensitive to it anymore, but if we could look around, we could look in our own lives and look at fellow Christians' lives and look in the church throughout the world and lives. We heard about Tanzania today. If we could look throughout in Sunday school, if we could look throughout all the world, we could see that the power of God is at work within us, the church, that he's already at work. He's already doing things that are pretty amazing if we could see them, if we could recognize them and ask God to open our eyes to what he is already accomplishing. But what he's saying is that's just the beginning. That's just the start of what's going on. It's going to go on and on and on, and it's going to go to from one glory to another glory, and it is going to achieve this thing unimaginable at the end, this thing beyond our. The same power at work today in us, he will bring it to completion. He will bring it through to the end. But this power is already at work within us. Don't only think of it as future. But it's already begun. It's already starting. Things are already happening. Things have happened to some of you. And I'm not talking about miracles necessarily, although some of you maybe could talk about that. But I'm talking about God has already done a work in your heart. If you could go back and talk to yourself, some of you 20 years ago or 30 years ago, and you would recognize, oh my gosh, that's who I was. That's where my mind was and my heart was. Look what God has already begun to do. It's just the beginning. It's just the glimmers. It's just the first flashes of what he's doing. He's already begun something. Something is happening here. Something is happening in me. Something's happening in the church. And what has he done throughout the world with the church spreading like wildfire everywhere? The church grows and grows and grows and grows to new people who had never heard before. And the church becomes strong in areas that we never thought of as Christian strongholds. And God is at work already. His power is already at work within us. And then we come to verse 21, where he says, to him, to God, to the same God that he's been talking about, be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. It means that Jesus Christ and the church, we are the ones, because Christ is at work in the church, we are the ones in this world that are bringing glory to God. We are the ones who are bringing our praise, that means bringing our praises to God, not only glorifying him by the way we live, but also in our praise of him and in our thanksgiving to him. And what I want to do is, because this prayer, which we've been studying for several weeks now, I think 4 weeks or something like that, and now we've come to this doxology at the end, and several weeks we've stopped to pray and we've asked God, we've repeated the requests and asked God to help us again. If you remember, it all began with us praying, strengthen us with power in our inner being. Strengthen us with power in our inner being. And the power we found out was the power of love in later weeks, right? The power of Christ in us, the power of love for others in us, and also the power of an experience or knowledge of God's love. Knowing God's love, the height and the width, the depth, all that, the length, all of that is what that means by the power within us. This is a power that the Holy Spirit works within us. We've been praying that, and we need to continue to pray that. Pray Paul's prayer from Ephesians chapter 3. But what I want us to do now is take a moment to praise him. I would like you, wherever you're at, to stand up and to give God praise. And we'll consider this a time of prayer. We will bow our heads, and we'll have a time of prayer. But anybody who would like to stand up where you're at, it doesn't have to be long, just as loud as you can, just praise God for what he is doing and what he is going to do. And even as much of this, the littlest glimmer that we have of it. I mean, once again, we're like that kid who grew up in Kansas and never, you know, before photographs and didn't know what the ocean looked like, couldn't imagine the ocean, and then sees the ocean. Of course, it's way beyond that. But we can't even comprehend what this is all about, what we're talking about here. I know we have trouble to even comprehend, but ask the Lord to help us to understand better what he's about and what he's doing, and to give him praise and to glorify him for what Jesus is doing. Because what Jesus is doing is beyond us, people. I mean, this week, what would happen to me this week is, as I was thinking about it, something bad would happen. It was the most fascinating thing to me. Something bad would happen, and I would be stirred up by it, frustrated, angry, irritated, or sad, or something. You know, bad things happening, bad emotions. And then I would say, you know, I need to think about salvation. I need to think about it. And I would just pause and think about it, and it would just lift me up again. It was like every time I would go back to Christ, I would be lifted again by my just taking my thoughts back to what is here in verse 20. That he, do you understand what he's doing? This silly, this thing that's bothering you right now is nothing compared to what he is doing. Do you understand the immensity? And this is why when we're talking about the power is beyond our imagination, but we're also being told that the love, remember, the love has this height and this depth, this width, this breadth and this length, because he's trying to use metaphors to say the immensity, the infinity of this, you cannot understand. You cannot grasp what is going on. But if you can grasp even a little bit this morning, will you praise God with me? Let's bow our heads. And anybody, whoever you are, wherever you are, let's stand up and praise God.
Thank you that your plan of redemption is not dependent on anything but yourself. But you let us be a part of it and invite us into it.
Jesus, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne, the Father, and to the Lamb, Jesus, be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Amen.
Would you continue in prayer with me just a moment? Father, we've heard wonderful things from your word this morning and wonderful praises from the lips of your people this morning. Would you help us by your mercy to present our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to you. Help us not to be conformed to this world, but that we would be transformed by the renewing of our minds so that we may discern what is your will, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Give us grace that we would not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but to think with sober judgment according to the measure of faith that God has assigned each of us. We're one body and we are not, and not all of us have the same function. So we who are many are one in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace you have given us. Let us minister in proportion to those gifts. The giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, and the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let our love be genuine, and grant that we would hate what is evil and hold fast to that which is good. And let us love one another and outdo one another in showing honor. Let us not fail in zeal, but be ardent in spirit and serve the Lord. Help us to rejoice in hope and be patient in suffering and to persevere in prayer. Help us as we contribute to the needs of the saints and extend hospitality to strangers. Help us to be able to bless those who persecute us and not to curse or react hostile to them. Help us to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. And grant that we would live in harmony with one another and not to be haughty, but be associate with the lowly. And let us not claim to be wiser than we are. Let us not repay anyone evil for evil, but take the thought of what is noble in the sight of all, and if it is possible, as much as we can, to live peaceably with all. If our enemies are hungry, let us feed them. If they're thirsty, let us give them something to drink. And grant that we would not be overcome by evil, but that we would overcome evil with good. We thank you for our missionaries. We thank you for David and Jordan Fleming, and we pray that you would bless their work in Tanzania. We pray for the Goodners with the loss of Cece's grandmother, that you would comfort that family. And pray for Larry and Francis Rogers as they continue to heal, that they would continue to gain strength and recover, that Francis would recover from her procedures. Give us relief by Jesus, our hope, faith in his name, our Savior, forgiveness by his blood, strength by his presence, and holiness by his Spirit. And let us love you with all of our hearts. Amen.
If you will take your bulletin out, let's stand together and sing One Pure and Holy Passion.
Give me one magnificent.
This morning, we're not coming up to get the supper. If anyone does need to get one, I'll put it there, and Anil. But there should be some in the pews in front of you that you can find the communion. This is, for those of you who haven't been with us before, the wafer is on the top layer, and then the juice is underneath and the bottom. So we're going to use this for communion this morning instead of the bread and wine up here. Let me read for you. Actually, no, let me not do that first. Let me say something first. This is the Lord's Supper. This is the supper that Jesus gave to his followers. If you are one of Christ's followers, if you have faith in Jesus, then eat and drink with us. This table is for sinners. These elements, this dinner, this supper, Jesus' supper is for sinners. He died for sinners. If you've been sinning this week, eat and drink if you have faith in Jesus. If you are repenting of those sins, like me, if you're sinning and confessing those sins and taking them to Jesus and looking to Jesus for salvation, then eat and drink with us. This is his table. This is Christ's table for all who he has died for to eat and drink. If you're living in sin and not repenting, then just today, repent. Do that. Don't eat and drink and pretend, but instead, don't let another day go by. But today, go to the Lord in prayer. Repent. Judge yourself. Judge your sins. Tell that to God. Confess those sins to God and receive the forgiveness of those sins. And then eat and drink with us in some future day down the road. We also ask the tiny little children who haven't yet been able to make the faith yet, been able to speak their faith yet, even in simple terms, that they not eat and drink until they reach that age and they can tell us about that they believe in Jesus too and participate in that. Let me read for you. Let's peel back. Anybody who needs one, if there's not enough, raise your hand and Anil will give it to you. It's a little bit tricky, so peel back to get the wafer exposed there. You also may find every now and then there's one that doesn't have a wafer, so if you have that problem, let us know and we'll give you one. Let me pray, and then I'll read and take us through this. Father in heaven, thank you for in your great love sending the Lord Jesus into the world, that what he has done for us, we have only begun to see what he has done, the amazing thing that he accomplished by his victory over sin and death, his victory over the devil, that he has won the victory, and he is now extending that victory into the world, and he will bring it to fulfillment, to conclusion one day. And in that day, he will sit down with us at this table, and he will eat and drink and feast with us in the kingdom of God. And we rejoice and look forward to that day. We thank you for giving us this sacrament that we can take week by week, eat and drink week by week by week, to be reminded of what Jesus has done for us, and also to receive, in a mysterious way that we don't understand, to receive spiritual nourishment from Christ. Just as the woman reached out and touched the hem of the garment, when we eat and drink in faith, we receive spiritual nourishment from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We put our faith in him, and we eat and drink in faith, and he strengthens us. So we ask that you would set aside this very ordinary bread, this very ordinary juice, for this holy purpose, that these would be the communion of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus as we eat and drink with faith in him. Pray this in his name. Amen. While they were eating together, Jesus took bread, he gave thanks to God, and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." If you have trouble getting yours open, you're not the only one. It takes me about 5 minutes to get it. Then Jesus took the cup, and he gave thanks to God again, and he offered it to them, his followers, his people, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins," which means we come as sinners, and by his forgiveness that he gives us, we receive all that we receive, all the glory and the wonder that God has for us comes to us because Jesus died to cleanse us of our sins. Let's drink. Now, I want you to understand that if you have faith in Jesus, as surely as that bread touched your lips and that juice touched your lips, as surely as that is the case, you have received from Jesus Christ. Jesus is with you. Now, to believe in him, even apart from the sacrament, to believe in him is to receive from Jesus and then to receive nourishment in this sacrament week by week by week. The Lord Jesus gives us to this to assure us, you're one of mine. You're eating at my table. Look, I'm offering you food. I'm giving you this food. This food is not coming from JR or coming from the Presbyterian Church. It's coming from Jesus. This is Jesus saying, "Let me feed you with my food. If you have faith in me, then know that the salvation that I am giving is yours, and you will receive it all. You will receive it all." Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you. Praise you for this glorious thing that you have done for us, this wonderful thing that you have done on our behalf. We give you praise. We rejoice. We thank you for bringing us here today, speaking to us and encouraging us from your word, enabling us to sing your praises, to pray to you, and now feeding us at this table. We thank you. We praise you. Go with us this week and continue to nourish us and strengthen us. Help us to lift our eyes to larger and larger visions of what you are doing and what you are accomplishing and what you will accomplish. Pour your hope into our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Pour your love into our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Pour your faith. Give us faith that we don't have. Strengthen that faith. Nourish that faith and help it to grow. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I always come down here without my bulletin, which I need. I'm on a search. We end the service with blessing, the last word of blessing, God's word of blessing on his people. I think I have it memorized, but I don't want to get caught, so I want to make sure it's in front of me. Will you stand up to receive this blessing? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship or communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and